DJ Boogie, what's happening?
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
What's happening?
Did you call him DJ Boogie?
D Boogie.
There's an L in there.
There's an L. Was that? What's the middle name?
There's an L.
That's the first name.
See, because he like messing up folks' name.
I know his name.
He messed with Carvey.
Look, Michelle. Like McDonald's, look, Michelle. Well, good morning, Boogie. Is Boogie part of the name?
He close. You're in the ballpark.
Can't get right.
And he's like, he's giving me.
I can say Boogie.
He give me a thumb up every
you
time.
Can't
but
say
here
Boogie.
You come.
You can't
being
say
his personal
Boogie.
Representative.
Everybody need one. Get you one.
Rep,
oh, you got one. Her
but
name
he's
is
got
Rhonda.
A manager.
Yeah, he has a manager.
I have the manager.
Yeah,
but
Rhonda.
Yeah.
Who got a medal?
Right. I'm still on my rookie contract here at WNOV, really? So I might need you to go and help me renegotiate my contract.
Good luck with that.
Still on the rookie contract.
I'm here on a wing and a prayer.
9 years later, I'm still on
every day
rookie.
I'm threatening to get I'm getting fired every day. I get off the air, and everybody be looking at the reception area like, keep on. Keep on. You can, why are you looking like that, D-Rock?
I have nothing to say.
Everybody be looking at me when I come off the air like, keep on.
Nothing to say.
You're going to be at the house. You gonna be at the house. Keep on, Negro. You gonna be at the house. Keep talking
so,
crazy.
Because you a free
so.
Black woman. You's a free Black woman.
I ain't free.
I love, no, you free.
I ain't free.
No, you free.
I ain't free.
Y'all act so funny. That's supposed to be your hand to move on to Axel.
Segway.
He tried to get me off of it.
Yeah, segway.
He tried to move me along. Everybody know I'm a constant threat of being terminated.
Every day. I got to defend my job.
Oh.
Lucretia Myers text.
He kept calling Lakeisha Lucretia. I said, who is Lucretia?
And I know her name is Lucretia.
That's her name. He said, that's what's in my phone.
Lucretia. Which is crazy.
I said, you put it in there.
Because go on YouTube. There's a sister name. She's passed now. Lucretia Campbell. She does a song called Magnify Him.
Mm-hmm.
Incredible. This woman has a soprano that you just will not believe.
Okay.
So that's Lucretia.
Like I thought you were going to tell
I know,
us
something
like a
sentence, relevant.
Something, yeah.
Something connected. If you're looking for Lucretia, there's Lucretia.
We weren't looking for
Lucretia. He's a weird man. He's such a weird.
I don't know why y'all can't get,
Wait, Keith.
I was going to say State Senator Latanya
Johnson.
No, Myers.
State Senator. She's a state representative.
Oh, okay.
Who?
But I like the self-fulfilling prophecy. I do. But yeah, right now she's still a state rep. But her name is Lakeisha. And then Depo said, it's in my phone as Lucretia. Because that's how you put it in there. I just can't keep saying that. And it's spelled L-E-C-R-E.
Oh, yeah, I broke it down to
me. And I'm like, are you serious right now, dude? He's about, that's her name. I'm like, bruh.
I forgot that part.
But anyway.
You the one spelled it that way.
The whole reason.
Now I got L-E-L-A. K-E-S-H-A is what I got now.
That is
no. Close enough. I know it'll spell Lakeisha.
Start with an L. Start with an L.
So how does she spell it?
L-A, capital K.
Oh, I didn't say K.
E-I-S-H-A.
Oh, boy.
Lakeisha.
Oh, well, let me see how I got it spelled now. Mine ain't totally wrong.
The password is Lakeisha.
Hey.
Lakeisha. You remember password?
Yeah.
Did you hear that voice?
Yeah.
And the password is?
Because we've had the password.
What am I missing? And now I got
L-A-K-E-S-H-A.
L A K E S H A.
He's just out here phonetically spelling stuff.
I mean, but it still would spell Lakeisha. I just missed an I somewhere.
All right. Well, the
which
reason
the I is silent.
He is bringing up Lakeisha, aka Lucretia, is because
Lucretia. Yeah, boys, you
that's a club. That's a club name.
Wait.
Everybody,
I thought your name was Lucretia.
Not with a mess. Wait a minute. It's Jugular Baby. Go ahead, baby.
Somebody called me Steve the other day and said, yep, that's my club name, Steve.
Steve is not a club name.
Keith, I know.
See,
how can Steve be a club name?
What would be a good, well, go on, do the accent. But we got to figure out what would be a good club name for a guy.
I need a good club name for you. Because, like, Debo was a good club name. Like, everybody like, oh, here come Debo. Okay. That's a club name.
Yeah.
El Boogie is a good club name.
But club names are not your real name for a reason.
Yeah, but most people think that my last name is like a nickname.
Yeah, nobody believes that's really his name. Nobody
believes that's my last name.
Because I've never actually heard of it before.
Well, I thought for many years, Homer Blow. I thought same thing.
You thought what?
Blow. Isn't Blow, isn't that
Blow is his real name, Blow?
Yeah, it's his government name, right?
Oh. No. No, hell.
Hey, Boogie, go
she'll
out
tell
there,
me that
go out there and cook me some coffee, man.
He said, she need a raise.
Wow.
But yeah, we'll come up with a club name for you. But I wanted to take a second. People may be hearing the commercials run that the NAACP is doing regarding their AXO competition. And I talked with Rep Myers because I had a couple of kids who wanted to participate, but they were not ready. And so they are going to extend the date until, I think it's this Friday. I'll have to check with her. But look, you all, if you know students that have any number of skill sets, whether they sing, dance, entertainment, they are technologically savvy, whatever that they do, they have the opportunity to compete locally, to win an ability to go to Las Vegas, to compete at the national level. I would say all these students that we have, and we are the drum and at the School of the Arts, and that participate in science competitions and the speech oratory competitions, Dr. King, King Fest, the King Celebration at the Marcus Center, the YMCA speech competition. If you have a young person or know someone with a skill, there are 32 categories. Please encourage them to reach out to the NAACP, leave their name and information. They can find out about the local competition and you know, do what they can to win that so that they can go to the national competition in July, in Las Vegas, all expenses paid. This is an amazing opportunity, and there are scholarships attached to these young people winning. So thank you, Keith, for letting me hang out for a second to be able to say that on your show.
I'm just going through my phone, Michelle. Did I spell Jeanette Herrera's name right? You know, since we on my spelling this morning. How you spell Jeanette?
Well, she doesn't spell her name like it.
G-E... A,
she spells her name J A. She doesn't spell her.
Have,
she
I spells J A N E T.
N E what?
N E T.
There's another T.
Oh, it's T T. And Jeanette.
That's just Janet, boy. J A N E T is Janet.
It's French.
Janet.
Janet.
He said it's French. Debo.
What?
He said it's French with
what
an A.
What you doing in school? Singing in the quartet?
What you
going to
make it? What you going to make it? J-A-N-E-T-T-E?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, I think you might.
But it's two
wrong.
T's. It is not one T. That's Janet.
You can
Janet
say Janet
Jackson.
Or you can say Jeanette. Or you can, no, you could go no, J-E-A. You say. That would be Jeanette.
Jeanette?
I don't know why you're looking to him for affirmation.
Yeah, because, you know, I got nothing going on over there. Look at him looking up in the ceiling.
What was this? Oh, my.
Well, real quick, why I have you here, though, do rapid fire.
Rapid fire.
Yeah, I did get to the ecumenical prep breakfast for our local electeds, particularly
leadership,
this was last Friday.
Week, Friday.
What? What is it? The Institute for
IPAMA.
IPAMA.
Mm-hmm.
There you go. I was at IPAMA. Really, let me shout out. Saw your guy, of course.
Who is my guy?
Antoine Reesby.
Boy, that's my man.
You know
I'm
that's your
you
guy.
Know.
You know that's my.
Love me some Antoine Reesby.
But really, they laid out the red carpet.
And this is the folks over at Holy Redeemer.
Holy Redeemer.
Okay, who have IPAMA?
Yes. Right. And so it was. It was very well attended. Mm-hmm. It was ecumenical. We did have the.
What does ecumenical mean?
Multi-religious.
Okay.
And so
folks,
we
just can't say the simple stuff, but go ahead.
Yeah, multiple, but we did have Archbishop Lasecki was there.
Mm-hmm.
We had the senior Rebbe from that,
the Rebbe?
Rebbe, yeah, Rabbi, Rebbe, Chief Rebbe. Okay. So it was student minister William Muhammad. We had people from various different Christian denominations. It was, so shout out Gerard Randall, the folks who put it together.
And what was the purpose of it?
It was just a prayer breakfast, you know.
For who?
Terms for the county exec and for the mayor.
Hmm. And you were invited?
Go for it. Yeah, because I wasn't. I was not invited.
Yeah. Thought they would have had some movers and shakers in there.
Oh, I told
bam,
them.
Bam! Shot well, fired!
They didn't want me to come.
There's a backstory to that, because when they had reached out to me, I said, I will not attend if you invite Michelle. So,
and they didn't.
See, the juice I got.
They did.
Yeah.
And I probably sent them back a response and said, your mama. So it worked out.
Yeah, I hear what. Hey, I hear when Michelle show up at your events.
Yeah.
She takes with me.
Really? Really?
Yeah.
Are, looking forward to that next town hall.
We, yeah, there's another town hall coming.
Another town hall coming.
Hey, Keith, watch this. Shot fired.
Look, if you don't shoot at me, my gun stays
hosted. Hey, Devo, hey, you can't take it nowhere. You can't go nowhere together.
What you mean?
We get the cloud. Oh, my God. We can't go nowhere.
Because it's you.
It's you.
If you would admit it's you.
If you, you just.
You don't know how to act. Miss Cliffy didn't do her job. You don't know how to act.
Now you, bro. It's not her fault. Your mama in there.
It's not her fault.
She did not beat you nearly enough.
Some would argue that that's
okay, but you was on rapid fire. Was that it? You
yeah, that was it. On that,
that was
piece.
It. Yeah, that was the end of your rapid that was fire. The rip.
No.
Well, what else you got, man? I gotta go. What else you got?
Oh, okay, but a piece.
Well, no, I want to do it.
Peace out.
Uh-huh. Why your voice get all elevated?
You know that's why you're supposed to say that.
Why you? Why?
I'm Michelle Bryan, and I'm out. No, you're right. On camera. You got
dudes. But oh, Ray Mackis.
Oh, Children's Church. I want to invite you to Children's Church, Michelle.
Why? Mm-hmm.
Don't do it.
Well, because I just think that you, you'd be such a wonderful.
That's not even flying out right now.
Let me be clear, Boo. I'll be great at Children's Church. Fantastic.
Wow.
They would only learn one curse word.
No, hell.
That they would learn when and where to use
it. They're going to be organized.
That's right.
They're going to be out protesting.
That's right. They will be able to secure, active. You know, a playground at the church for them during service.
I love children. Hey, I
gonna,
love Children's Church.
You're going to know she's been there because all the kids are going to be like, first off, Pastor, bruh.
Just so we clear. Just so we clear.
Raggedy. Raggedy gonna have a whole new vocabulary.
Inappropriate.
I bring more to the table than this.
But what I guess this came up when I was talking to Theo Liskin last week, and he was talking about his sons. I mean, kids listening to hip hop.
Yeah.
And there were certain people, they got to a certain age, they can sit down and listen to it together.
Right.
So I always poll the kids at the end of children's church, you know, what's your favorite color? How you doing in school? And so I asked them, like, what's your favorite movie? Do you know half these kids, and all of them are under 12,
okay,
had watched slasher movies?
Oh, yeah.
One kid was sitting up there arguing with me about Michael Myers.
Yeah.
Somebody else brought up Freddy Krueger. I'm going like, dude, you're 8, you're 9. How are you watching this?
Mm.
So what is too young?
I mean, I never subscribe to, you know, kids under a certain age watching that kind of stuff. I
How was
been,
your son when he was watching movies?
Derek was good in 14, 15. Because okay. Number one, because I don't watch those kind of movies anyway.
Okay.
It's just not my thing. Yeah. I don't like scary movies, slasher movies. But yeah, he was in high school when he started. Unless he went to his cousin's house. And
oh,
it was
you know, he was sneaking. He was sneaking.
He wasn't even sneaking. Project Hoodlums. He just was, he was doing he was.
Is that a term of endemic for his
cousins? Project Hoodlums. That's your regular hoodlums. We're talking about the Project Hoodlums.
Oh, for his cousins.
Wow. On all the platforms we have, we know that their cousins are now Project Hoodlums.
Look, they know it, and we gladly own it. It'd be like, TT loves us, but yeah. But no, I just, you know, a lot of that is just parents make.
Right.
Because you can put parental controls on your television. You can't stop what they see at school and what people download on their phone, and you can pull up crap on your phone. But people just don't do what they need to do by way of due diligence to protect their children. And some of them just don't care that they get exposed to that stuff.
Well, there were people who were blaming rap videos
for everything,
for their language that their kids were using,
as opposed to their mom and their daddy.
Yeah, because I want to know what year was it rap that brought cussing? They created these cuss words.
Let me be clear. I'm older than rap is. I learned how to cuss from my granddaddy.
Yeah.
Point blank, period. Nope. Because my mama doesn't swear or didn't swear.
Okay.
You know, you have to do something for real for Mozella to jump out the box on you.
But when she did.
Oh, yeah. But when she came, she remembered who her daddy was. But my granddaddy was cussing just because he woke up. You know?
Yeah.
Get me a damn cup of coffee. Like, and it wasn't flagrant. It didn't sound foul. It was just flavorful.
Did I tell
and
you,
colorful.
Ever tell you a story about the little girl who pushed me down on the bike? And I got twisted.
You were just abused by everybody.
Oh, man, especially girls. Jeez. Which was the other thing that came up. These kids.
How old were you?
I had to be about 9 or 10.
You got pushed down on a bike at 9 and 10?
I'm wrapped up in the bike. By a girl. So I jumped up and called her the B word.
You did?
Yeah. I didn't know that was in me.
Keith did that?
And a couple other words.
Ooh,
what? So you know what girls do? She went and told my grandmother.
Uh-oh.
So my grandma said, okay, honey, I'll tell his mama. So my mom comes to pick me up, and my grandma lived on First and Wright. We lived on Palmer and Center. So my grandma tells what the little girl said. We walk down the stairs. We're walking up First Street. I'll never forget this. And my mama is cussing me out. Oh, she just. And then she said, I don't know where you learned these words anyway. And I'm looking at her going like, oh, I'm not going to say where I'm learning them.
I've been
in a dance course right now.
When you get confronted with your cuss words and your bad parenting, because I went, after my son graduated from high school real quick, I went to McDonald's up here on 76 in Capitol. I'm in the drive-thru, and this little girl that's waiting on me, she kept staring at me, you know, when she was taking my money and stuff. And she was like, do you have a son named Derek? I said, yeah. She said, oh my God, I knew you was his mother. You look just like him, or he looks just like you. I said, oh, okay. I said, so you know my son? She said, everybody know your cussing son.
Ooh.
Ooh. I was like, cussing? My son don't cuss? She was like, lady, please.
Sounded like Steven. Because
you don't know your son.
My son does not cuss in front of me. And when I say like never, my son never curses in front of me.
Oh no! Your son is smart.
Yeah, I ain't cuss in front of my mom.
What intelligent child would cuss in front of their parent?
When you tell a kid, you ain't gonna be playing all them old cussing ass videos in my house. Right. I ain't gonna keep telling you.
Remember, I don't know if you ever watched The Shears.
The Shears.
That is what's her name?
The Christian people.
Bishop Shear. Remember they had a reality show, right?
I didn't see it. Never even watched an episode.
So one day, you know, his son is producer. Obviously, Kier is the singer, yeah. Right?
Right.
So they're going back and forth about whether or not he should be producing her album. And they're going back and forth. And she said, no, I want to bring in somebody else because, you know, D Moss is their first cousin. I want to bring in da 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 da. And so dad is there, mom is there. She kind of steps back. Dad is kind of da 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 da. And so then his son said, damn, daddy, I know what the hell I'm doing. He wasn't Bishop Shear. He said, do me a favor, turn the camera off. He said, turn that camera off. Yeah. Oh, I know he wore him out.
Because you can't. Oh, and then you're doing it, and it's getting caught on film too. But I just, we didn't cuss.
When I went, and wait a minute, I went to PWIs. So in the dorm, you'd be walking past, listening to these white kids talking to their parents, and you'd be going like,
Oh yeah, you talking to your mama?
Your mama? He's like,
yeah.
No. Bring it, mama. I told you. I'm like, still at PWI. Is that predominantly white institution?
Predominantly white institution. Well,
you know, break that down for us slow people. It took me a while. I was still on that. Now, what did they do? What was happening?
With white PWI? Kids are able to cuss at their parents.
Oh.
And look, so I'm going to get out of here.
Okay.
But while I got a second.
You promise? This time?
I just said, tomorrow I'm going to talk about HBCUs.
Okay.
What happened down at Tennessee State.
Okay.
Yeah. In which the white Republican controlled legislature came in and took over their board. Basically their board of regents that governs the university. Mm-hmm. And that this is a playbook that we are getting ready to see all over the country. A whole bunch of us going to be at PWIs if these Republicans have their way, because since the Biden-Harris administration called them out on the billions of dollars that they stole from HBCUs, Tennessee State took had $500 million taken from them by local state Republicans. And Tennessee State had the audacity to say, we want our money. The governor said, well, we'll give y'all $250 million of it, but you stole $500 million. And we'll make sure you spend it correctly. And one of the ways we're doing that now is we're taking over your board. So I got to bring that up tomorrow, because we all going to be at PWIs.
So when that $250 million was offered, if they had said, no, we're not going to accept that, they could have actually just closed the school, couldn't they?
I mean, all of these HBCUs that are state-run schools could be subject to being closed, because the state legislature...
But it's one of their largest schools in the UT system.
Yeah, but they have been for years trying to get it and turn it to a situation where it's a PWI.
Right.
And because it's located right in the Capitol, you know, and so
Jefferson Street.
The scandalous thing is that it's happening in front of us, and other people are going, because there were 13 schools that the Biden administration identified, historically black colleges, land grant universities, where the states have stolen their money and diverted it to other schools or other places. And they're like, do you know how much better, like when we go down and we complain about the dorms, we complain about, you know, the buildings not being updated. And we think this is all mismanagement or lack of trying of the black faculty and folks that lead these schools they're under resourced. And so we go to white schools and like, oh, look at everything they got, because you're using a lot of our money to help build it. So that's something I just wanted to flag for people. I'm going to talk tomorrow. About tomorrow. So thank you for letting me do that.
Thank you. And thank you.
Michelle, remind folks too that we're going to be watching the proceedings with. Yeah, go ahead.
Because I heard that's going to be decided on my program.
On your program or within the time frame?
Within, you said by the time I come on the air, right?
Yeah, by the time you come on the air. Well, the vote starts at 9.
Right.
So it don't take all day. So hopefully we'll know before you get off the air.
All right. You're listening to Community Voice. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back.
Are you ready to take care of your financial future? Listen up for 30 seconds of savvy advice on making smart money decisions. First, budget with a purpose. Track your expenses and prioritize your spending. Next, save for a rainy day. Start an emergency fund to cover unexpected expenses. And don't forget to invest in your future. Whether it's stocks, bonds, or real estate, make your money work for you. Ready to unlock your financial potential? Start making smart money decisions today.
April is Financial Literacy Month. Presented by the Milwaukee County Office of Equity, we invite you, the listeners of WNOV, to learn more about how to protect, grow, and invest your dollars.
Impressions will exceed your expectations. Great impressions, perceptions, everything.
Are you ready to make a lasting impression? Look no further than Great Impressions Graphics and Printing. With over 25 years of excellence in the industry, we specialize in delivering top-notch printing solutions tailored to your corporate needs. Business cards, brochures, banners, annual reports, apparel, and promotional items. Our state-of-the-art technology ensures unmatched quality and precision. Call 414-536-7646 or visit greatimpress.com today to learn more. Trust Great Impressions to exceed your expectations and elevate your brand to new heights.
Great impressions, perceptions, everything.
The Center for Teaching Entrepreneurship presents its third annual Big Head Soiree Thursday, May 16th at the Marcus Performing Arts Center in the Bradley Pavilion. I'm Andrea Williams, and I'll be your host for this spectacular event. It's designed to salute the co-founder, Miss Radonna Rogers, as she loved to wear big hats. And this is one way we honor her. We will also celebrate and recognize the accomplishments of Milwaukee's leaders in entrepreneurial ventures. So, ladies, this is the time to wear your big hat and, guys, your stylish fedora. You will be treated to a delectable dinner and the sounds of Soul Sirius starting at 5:30. The program will begin at 7 with more entertainment and the awards program. Tickets are just $75. Go to Eventbrite using BHS24 or call 414-788-8104. That's 414-788-8104. This event will kick off the spring season, so don't miss it.
Hello, Milwaukee. I'm Mr. Debo, the program director here at the all-new 860 WNOV. On January 8th of this year, WNOV underwent a relaunch, complete with a fresh logo, branding, format, and new shows. Now you can even stream our talk shows on YouTube and Facebook. We're always striving to enhance your listening experience, and now your watching experience too. As we continue to work on improving, there may be more changes in our lineup. Here's a few of the changes we've made. We've added Sandra Silk and All That Jazz on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Chris Heavy Levy on Saturdays with Saturday Backtracks and more. Flavor Fix with foodie Samantha Starr. How about Pillow Talk with me, Mr. Debo, on the Porch with Kwai, with Kwabenon Anton Nixon. The Difference with Will Martin. Be a Voice with Wisconsin Voices, Dr. Kwaku and Naumbo Mpendo. Money Talks with attorney Carl Plez. Brought to you by Columbia Savings and Loan. The Friday Night Jukebox Party with DJ Kevin Buchanan. St. Mark's Lutheran Church with Pastor Marty from 9 a.m. until 9:30 a.m. Community Outreach Clinics, Community Heartbeat, with more to come. But rest assured, of course, we have our staple shows that have not changed and will not change. Say Something Real with Michelle Bryant. Community Voice with Keith Paris. International Roots Rock Reggae Meltdown with Ross Joel. The Blues Cafe with me, Mr. Debo. Reverend Al Sharpton from 12 until 3. We're listening to you, and we'll get it right together. And thank you for listening to the all-new 860 WNOV and 106.5 FM, The Voice.
You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293 CX 106.5 Milwaukee. You're inside Community Voice on WNOV 860 AM and 106.5 FM with your host, Keith Paris.
All right, welcome back to Community Voice. And as we lead up to Juneteenth Day, we have some good folks here who are part of the whole Juneteenth celebration this year. But I got to ask a quick question first. Debo, was that a stand-up upright bass the guy was playing?
It's Coltrane, man.
Wow. Wow. You don't see a lot of that anymore. My mother allegedly said that when she was in the band in high school, she played upright bass.
Allegedly.
I have no proof. Not that my mother would ever lie to me.
She would not.
That ain't your daddy. That ain't your daddy.
She would not.
So I have a studio with Mr. George Akpan.
Yes, sir.
Miss Nicole Goins.
Yes, sir. Good morning.
And Pastor Andrew Calhoun. You folks are all part of the organizing group there for Juneteenth. So why don't we start with you, Nicole? Tell us what your role is.
No. We're starting with
Nicole,
me.
Nicole.
No, okay.
You're on camera.
I know. I know. And I'm glad to be here. Trust me. So I am Nicole Goins. I am the co-chair with Mr. Akpan for the parade committee. Well, so it's my first year as a co-chair. I am definitely elated because I know that we have some amazing things going on and in our plans. It's definitely our goal to ensure that there's a safe, yet another historical parade for our city. So.
Thank you. As Nicole just stated, she is my lovely co-chairman of the Juneteenth Jubilee Parade. My name is George Jack Penn Jr. I've been a part of the parade for the last 3 years, serving as the chairman, and we're excited to bring back yet another staple of our Juneteenth celebration here in Milwaukee. It's nothing but family fun. As you said, it will be a safe parade. They're very thankful for our partners in the community.
A long parade.
A long parade. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
We working on that.
We still got people coming up to
read. No.
That was the longest parade I've ever seen in my whole life. That was a long parade.
Year was actually the longest one we've had in our history. Yeah. So you are correct.
We get all 50 years in. Oh, that was, but that's beautiful though, because it's how the community, but there's people joining it because we're part of the parade. And so we're kind of in the front.
Correct.
So I'm walking back to my workstation and parade's still going. Okay. I said, let me walk down to Bader. Parade still coming. Now, some of these people, I don't know what organizations they represented, but that's our community piece that everybody. So thank you. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Yes, I am. I'm Pastor Andrew Calhoun. I'm the chairman for the Vet Zone. This would be the second year. We started last year and had about five different vet organizations represented in zone. We set up our shop in Rolls Park, which is along Martin Luther King. This year, we're trying to expand that zone by twice the size with the number of vet organizations. And we're interested in any vet organization who would like to become part of the zone. But please contact Norcott or can contact me directly.
So when you talk about this particular, we talk about the veterans. I'd love when you go out to Woods. I just love when you go out to the VA because dudes be represented. They represent the war that they was in. They represent. We have a significant number of Black veterans, right, here in the city.
Yes. And leading off the parade for the last 20 years has been Company F, a reenactment of Black veterans. And so they're going to have an encampment site set up in the Vet Zone as well as lead again in the parade.
Are these Civil War reenactors?
Yes.
Okay. And, you know, I had a friend who was a Revolutionary War reenactor, but be able to see those folks every year, and the women, too.
Yes.
When they come dressed, yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's why is it important for you all to reach out to our veterans, especially on Juneteenth Day?
Well, I tell you what, it's part of the message coming to about in Texas was delivered by the cavalry, by the military to part of Texas to let them know that liberation, emancipation had occurred. So it has a unique tie there. Plus, you look at what the Civil War is all fought about in the first place.
Always gets back to slavery, don't it? So when you talk about this year, we're going to, what's the time we go from what to what?
So our parade steps off at 14th and Atkinson to Locust and Martin Luther King Drive, and it begins at 9 a.m. to 11 a.m.
A couple of years ago, Shannon was trying to explain why we didn't start on time. And she said, you know, it's a cultural thing with our people.
It is. There we go. That's the answer.
Yes and no. Yes
and no. Hey, same thing in that church.
Right. Yes.
And the choir folks.
Well, you know what?
You know what? That was 5 minutes ago.
Well, it took them 2 years of Galveston to even find out that they've been freed. So, you know, we might start a little late, but there's some historical background.
Sure.
To what we're looking at. I think, and let me commend the good folks here, because it is of all, we have a lot of things we can celebrate in this city. But I was telling the story when there's a guy who used to play talk much professional basketball here, Freddie Carter. And so Freddie and his wife was here for about a year and a half, maybe 2 years. His wife is from D.C. And so he came back. We we graduated from the same college. He came back to coach. His wife says, oh, you're from Milwaukee. Like, yeah, yeah. She said, oh, what's that thing y'all do when y'all shut down the street and y'all got thousands of people? I said, that's Juneteenth Day.
It's Juneteenth.
And she said, oh, that is really, really nice because we don't do that in D.C. And if you've ever been to D.C. and you see, I used to go to Malcolm X's birthday in Anacostia Park. About 2 hours into it, it's broke up, right? Somebody did something now, and we got the National Park Police. And so the fact that we do it peacefully every year. It says a whole lot. And folks are coming back.
Right.
Yeah, I think they said last year, I think set a record of over 170,000 people showed up.
Yeah.
To the party, and Norcott just recently, because of Juneteenth, just received a governor's award for tourism. So it's been a big plus.
You know, you talk about your work with the veterans. Tell us a little bit about your background and how you got involved with the veterans.
Oh yes, I've spent 12 years active duty, a couple years in reserves with the United States Navy. As a Navy chaplain, I first came to Milwaukee as the first Navy chaplain assigned to the Coast Guard here downtown. And so my connections have been that I've traveled at least 14, 15 different countries. And so you're proud of seeing exactly what your service does, you know. And when you come back in the United States, you're more thankful and grateful for what you have available for freedoms.
You know, it's we're like Vietnam age in terms of when that was happening and how people reacted to soldiers returning home. And it was a lot of hostility because of just hostility towards that war, very unpopular war. And so for a long time, folks in the military just wasn't getting the level of respect.
True. Or services or support. When
support,
it came back.
Right. And so you see one, I know people talk about the wait time, but they love the service that they get at the VA.
Correct.
Which means that they've been increasing that. But in terms of the history of Black veterans, there were men who fought in World War II and in the Korean War who were eligible for the GI Bill and were denied. And yet they served their country.
Correct.
You know, and so we do this, and we don't always get the love in return.
True. Yet
there's something about America's not perfect, but am I going on a limb to say that in some way we love America?
Oh, yes. I think, you know, like I said, once you serve in the military and you travel overseas and really see what the rest of the world looks like, you come back and say, Lord, I thought I had it bad, you know, and your level of services, I think we could do a lot more because still a lot of servicemen are struggling because of the trauma experience they've gone through, but they don't want to create no fuss. Mm-hmm. And so forth, they will just leave me alone, you know.
And that's why that veteran zone is probably very good. I also do the stand down.
Sure.
But the veterans know, hey, I can get help.
Yeah, we have several groups coming out this year. In fact, we have a few recruiters coming out. In fact, the Coast Guard just opened up a recruiting station here.
Okay.
Haven't had one in 20 years.
Okay.
And they're going to be there with us, as well as another one, Healing Warriors Hearts is another group that's going to be there, provide resources for our veterans. Last year, we had a disabled veterans had a kind of a van type situation where you can come and get services and talk in private and stuff like this. So we're just trying to reach out to all the veterans that there. Some of them are suffering, continue to suffer in silence.
Mm-hmm.
So we're just trying to do a better job.
And now we're talking about when they're suffering in silence, they're self-medicating.
Yes.
There's just because of that. I those people who were certainly in combat zones and the trauma that these people experience, I said we came up during the Vietnam era, but hearing veterans from World War II and the Korean War
sure.
talk about the difficulties and, oh man, what you see, you know, you never want to, you can't even describe it. You try to bury it in your subconscious. that idea of war. And so when they come back, they're I know they have a group out there, Wounded Warriors. But if you're not physically wounded and you experienced like war, you're traumatized.
Yeah. Yes. In fact, we started doing some of our geology, kind of find out one of my great uncles served in the submarines. Mm-hmm. And he's mentioned in the book, he was a porter on the submarines, and he followed the CEO around on several different boats. And he talked about the near misses and near death charges and so forth, came out. Brilliant man. He's ended up working. He was very smart. He ended up working, got a job with GE, and was dealing with electronics. And so, but he served his whole career with the submarine force.
It's amazing. And so I think we need to do more of the group we work with the Stand Down Stry Hooch.
Sure.
But to be able to, and I've worked with Black veterans back in the day when Willie Abney and the other guys were there. It's Bill Cockcroft. I mean, just folks that you know. And so I think that's great that there's really a focus there. And hopefully these men are going to take advantage of that. Nicole?
Hey.
So your role in all of this is?
Co-chair to Mr. Akpan over the entire parade.
And Juneteenth is just more than the parade, right?
It is, but I think the parade is a big deal. Like we already said, for me, I had the opportunity to visit the parade, the Juneteenth parade in Atlanta. So I had a chance to compare the two, and just knowing that Atlanta, of course, is on the map when it comes to, like, you know, Black culture and all of that good stuff. But to see and know that we do it bigger than Atlanta, that's a big deal, I think. And
I think we're bigger than Chicago.
Yeah, it really is.
Because it really is a community-wide event. I mean, where it is. And like I said, people are returning. You know, you get to the point where someone showed me a shot standing on Burleigh, mm-hmm. looking down King Drive. Mm-hmm. And I mean,
isn't that
that's like, incredible?
That speaks volumes.
Right.
I feel like just to have that photo says it all.
Right.
Regardless of whatever, you know, other issues or things like that.
Didn't happen during Juneteenth.
It didn't have to have anything. I'm putting that on the record on the air. Nothing to do with Juneteenth. So yeah. We're leaving that behind us. Hold and just
they had over, I think, 470 something vendors last year on the street.
470, and we had George, correct? 170 participate in the parade.
Yes.
Wow.
In the county, we have every department out. We have our village. Our village is right up there, right above right above Burleigh. I had so many memories of Juneteenth going back. I mean, just some of the stuff that happened. But to see people.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's the one thing about Juneteenth. You're going to see some folks.
Absolutely.
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, it is. And I like that it's the village.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the village. And those who grew up in Milwaukee understand the significance of King Drive. Let's go back to what it was. 3rd Street,
yeah.
That was in the heart of our community, mm-hmm. for many of us, you know, 53212. And so, excuse me, the historical significance of that street now that it's MLK. It's because I think VA is in the old Curly's building.
There's one down on King Drive. It's the outreach center.
Right, their outreach center there. And I'm very proud. I'm very proud to say I'm from Milwaukee, not just for Juneteenth, just period. I don't know how people, you don't love your city.
Mm-hmm.
I don't. Why are you still here? No, I mean, you know what I mean? I mean, just
sure.
you do, you know, but it's how we express it. And then, like you say, you go visit someplace else and you go, oh, okay. Yeah, maybe not.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so to be able to do it in such a way. They're always looking for volunteers.
Yes, we are. We're looking for over 100 volunteers this year to assist us with the parade. But there are opportunities outside of the parade to also volunteer. If you would like to volunteer for the parade, we ask that you are at least 18 years or older. You know, you'll get a free T-shirt, and we want you to participate with a minimum of 3 hours of volunteerism.
Yeah.
Yeah, and our theme this year is our history, our culture, and our village is our theme this year.
Our history?
Mm-hmm. Our history, our culture, and our village.
And our village. Yeah, you know, there's so many things that we don't even think about. There's this term, Sunday's best, mm-hmm. that comes from Juneteenth, right? Because mm-hmm. when the recently enslaved people in Galveston, they went all out, you know, and so they put on the clothes that they wore.
Yeah, I think in some of the historical context, it was first announced in part of church announcements at AME Church. They, you know, hey, you got to get the word out. Well, everybody come to church, right?
And this is why I love all African people all over the world, because only descendants of enslaved African people can make announcements a thing in church.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's a thing. I mean,
absolutely.
You're listening to Community Voice. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
It's Boost Mobile here with a great deal to keep you connected and help you make the most of your tax refund. When you switch to Boost, you get 4 lines for $100, plus 4 free 5G smartphones, like the Samsung Galaxy A15 or the Moto G Stylus 5G. We're here to bring you the best phones on America's largest 5G networks, so you can get after it. Switching is easy. Just head to your local Boost Mobile store for 4 lines and 4 phones for $100. Visit BoostMobile.com for details. New customers only. Requires auto pay and ID verification. Other restrictions apply. See participating dealers for details.
Hello, I'm Vanessa, co-chair of the Juneteenth Vendors.
I am Frank, co-chair of the Juneteenth Volunteers.
Juneteenth is fastly approaching and space is always limited. So if you have an interest in being a vendor, you need to sign up today.
Juneteenth would not be successful unless we have volunteers. We need volunteers for a multitude of different areas. So companies, corporations, organizations, Divine Nine, even families, please sign up to be volunteers today.
So call Northcott Neighborhood House today at 414-372-3770.
Vendors and volunteers call today at 414-372-3770.
Thank you.
Milwaukee, tune in to Mary H. Bryant's television show, which airs each and every second Sunday morning at 6 a.m. on the M. That's WMLW-TV at 6 a.m. You'll find us on WMLW-TV, AT&T 7, Spectrum 7, Direct, and Dish TV 49 every second Sunday morning at 6 a.m. And join us on June 16th, 24th for the Mary 35th Annual Father's Day Sunset Cruise and the Blues. We're showcasing Jason National and blues artists with old-time gut bucket blues. You'll love the tunes, so tune us in. Any questions? 414-463-6977.
The Wisconsin Home Energy Assistance Program end of the season is approaching. Don't miss out on benefits and help with your WE energy bill. Just go to keepwarmmke.org. It's made it easy for you to schedule an appointment. You may also call 414-270-4653. Don't delay. Call us today. Again, that's 414-270-4653. Or visit us online at keepwarmmke.org. This is administered by the State of Wisconsin Home Energy Plus Program.
Get ready, Wisconsin. The Black Child Development Institute is expanding its village statewide. Join us for an unforgettable evening of celebration and empowerment at our gala on Saturday, May 4th, 2024 at the Hilton Milwaukee City Center. Tickets are available for $150 per person and sponsorships are available. Adorn yourself in formal African attire as we celebrate this momentous occasion and the growth of our village. For more information and to purchase tickets, call 414-236-5641 or visit bcdi-wisconsin.org. That is 414-236-5641 or bcdi-wisconsin.org. Don't miss out on this unforgettable event. Together, let's build a brighter future for Wisconsin's children. Mm-hmm.
You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293 CX 106.5 Milwaukee. Now back to Community Voice with your host Keith Harris and Devon Jones, DJ the Protege.
All right, welcome back to Community Voice. As I'm sitting here ranting and raving off the air. Again, you're looking for volunteers. Is there a number?
We are looking for over 100 volunteers to participate in our parade this year. We want those individuals to be over 18 years old. They'll ask they'll be answering frequently asked questions from not only parade participants, but spectators and folks who are coming out to help us celebrate this grand tradition. And we want those folks to be firm and friendly and available for check-in as early as 7 a.m. and to stick around with us as late as 12 to 1 p.m.
The number I got, Norcott, is 414-372-3770.
George, let me ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
Your folks in Nigeria.
Yes, they are.
We have a significant African presence at Juneteenth Day, right?
Yes, we do.
That's cool. No, I just thought, mm-hmm. You know, it's one of those interesting pieces where how we've experienced our racism, you know, colonialism, that type of domination, and then what we see here, apartheid here, right? Sure. And so I just wondered, you know, how do indigenous African people think about something like Juneteenth?
Well, in my experience, I grew up on 7th and Burleigh, so I've always been around to visit the Juneteenth celebration. Of my grandfather, he helped establish the Nigerian community in Milwaukee.
Okay.
They're off of 76 in Appleton.
Okay.
He used to be a part of Afrofest, if you recall, mm-hmm. back at Summerfest Grounds.
Okay.
And our most recent Miss Juneteenth is also a Nigerian. And so
that's right.
We have a lot of involvement. Some of the vendors, you'll be able to buy some Kente clothing. And we all just try to come together as we look at it as a myriad of Black folks, no matter if you're African American, you're born in the United States, or if you're scattered around the globe and part of our...
It's what W.E.B. Du Bois called Pan-Africanism. That was
yes.
That
coin.
Yep, yep, yep.
And now we talk about the diaspora.
The diaspora.
And that's why I love all African people all over the world, because I'm going to tell you something. Get around some African people, and after a while, you know, at first we get to our little subcultural issues. After a while, we kind of go, I know you. I know you. So I appreciate that and being able to, again, it's the village. It's the village. Let me thank Mr. George Akpa. I do it right?
Yes, sir.
Miss Nicole Goins.
Yes, sir.
Pastor Andrew Calhoun.
Yeah.
Of the Juneteenth Organizing Committee. We appreciate that. I know you're coming back as we get closer and closer. And that parade is almost over.
No, can I just add one thing real quick? Just want to let everyone know that applications for both the parade, to participate in the parade or volunteer, are available on the website, JuneteenthMilwaukee.com. And we do have PDF format, as well as they could actually complete that application electronically this year. So that's something amazing.
Indeed. And we're bringing back our competitions. Mm-hmm. Through our competitions, we've been able to give back nearly $20,000 over the last 2 years.
When you say competitions, what do you mean?
So competitions, we'll have competitions for the best bends, best floats, and best dance groups. We've been able to give back the money. You know, you can win up to $2,000. Most of them are $1,000.
Okay.
But we want everyone who has an organization centered around community, the youth, to participate and just, you know, add to the fun and the celebration we have.
You're listening to Community Voice. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back.
Listen, everybody. Listen up good now. Listen, everybody. Listen up good now.
All right, welcome back to Community Voice. And as you know, we partner with Milwaukee Films Black Lens. And that program started, let me give you the dates. I know it started already. Started on April the 11th. That would have been last Thursday. We have in studio with us Mr. Eric D. Seals. Right, he is the director.
Yes. Oh, there we go. There we go.
And he is the director of the movie Bike Vessel.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
What's happening, man?
Happy to be here. Thank y'all for having me.
All right, man. Let's see. You's from?
Chicago.
From yep. Chicago.
Chicago, you know, just a little larger Milwaukee. We're about the same. Okay. Just a little bit.
A little larger.
Just a little larger.
Like 9 times larger. But this is a very fascinating documentary. As a matter of fact, my colleague was asking what movie we go to Black Lens.
Yes.
And we bring the Black movie experience with us when we go to Black Lens.
Good.
You know how Black people go to movies.
Yeah, oh, I know. I know. I know when my I know when my cousins are watching the film. You know, like I'll go into the theater. I'm like, oh, my cousins are here today.
Yo, man, we got the roller commentary going.
Good, though. I love it. That's what it's about.
But this is one of the movies that she wanted us to go see together.
I'm happy to hear that.
Bike Vessel.
Yes, yes.
Give us the premise.
So, my father had 3 open heart surgeries in the span of 20 years, and in about 2016. He was making it. He was here, but he wasn't here. Like, he was here. And my wife at the time, I'm sorry, my fiance, but now wife, decided to challenge my dad to a tennis match because he used to play tennis recreationally. And I'm like, you know what? I'm going to record this just to have receipts. Because, you know, sometimes our community, we forget, you know, if we won the game or not, if it goes too far away. So I'm like, let me record this just in case.
But they got a whole commercial that now.
Oh, yeah.
Say, when we go back.
Yeah, 100%.
We're going to do the review.
Yeah. We need to review this.
We need a review.
And so I recorded it. I showed him the footage the next day because obviously he just got whooped. And he's like, man, I haven't seen myself on camera in so long. I'm not looking how I want to look. And so the very next day he went out and bought a bike. And he called me and he said, I can't get around the block. I said, that sounds like a horrible idea. I don't know why you went to go buy a bike. He's like, I needed to do something.
Right.
And so I think if it wasn't for the return policy, like he bought, you know, one off of clearance or something like that, he would have returned it. But my mom was like, you're not returning that bike. You're going to start riding it. And he started riding it every day, trying to get around the block. A quarter of a mile was a big deal at first. And so I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to start filming his journey. It wasn't a film at that time. I'm going to film his journey.
Fast forward to several years later, and he's all he's off of at least he would take about 20 pills a day to for as long as I can remember. He's down to 1 to 2 pills a day. He rides about 30 to 50 miles a day now, over 150 in a week. And we rode our bike from St. Louis to Chicago to celebrate him transforming his life, which was 350 miles. So it was one of those situations where, because I'm a filmmaker, I run a video film production company, and I was watching him, and I'm like, I need to do something. He's out here trying to make a change at 65, and I was 30, whatever, at the time. I don't know. I stopped counting. I'm 34, 35 at the time. I'm like, I need to do something. So I decided to join him, and I bought a bike, and we started riding together.
You know, it seems, and this is probably anecdotal. I don't have anything in terms of people did. Mm-hmm. But it seems like, especially for men, you know, we peak athletically, physically about 28, 29. Yep. And then 30 is like a dark period, man. I mean, I look at my 30 pictures, and it's kind of like you don't care about how you look, you know, and don't get married. Now you're settled.
Listen, you're comfortable now.
Yeah, you're comfortable. So they're getting off the couch, you know. And so you get that, then people get like 40, 50.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden now, because now we're a little bit more mindful of our mortality.
Yep.
Right. 100%. That now, I'm going to try to stay. So it's not surprising that he was at that point in his life where he made that decision.
Sure, sure.
Because a lot of people, you know, they really do. They decide later that I'm going to really be healthy.
And you know, one of the things, like, so I play college football. He played college ball. I played at a school in Kentucky called Murray State. It was D1AA. I don't know what they called that. Nobody was saying that when I went there, though, because he ain't gone there yet at that point. But
the Fry twins were there too.
Yes. Yes.
You know Fry?
Yes, yeah, I do. Yeah, yeah. I do. Wasn't that really good? I was there on the team, but it's not like I wasn't Barry Sanders or anything.
A contributor.
Yeah, I was. I showed up to practice.
Every day, right? Rudy, that kid's out there every day giving it all. But he'll never play.
He'll never play. But here's the thing. I was playing football pretty much all my life. And my whole training, eating-wise, was eat as much as you can. Like, my coaches were yelling at me, you're not eating enough. You're not eating enough. And that gets ingrained in your brain. And then you stop playing football, and your brain is still coasting on that. And so I'm still working on that to this day. But you know, the way that I look at athletes sometimes when they're done training, it's sometimes an unfortunate situation.
Because Muhammad Ali talked about this, you know, especially for heavyweights, right? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it's not so much making weight, where if you're bantamweight, welterweight, it's always about making weight. For them, it's like getting in the best shape, but then your diet has a lot to do with it because you're a big person.
Man.
So once you're out of training,
man,
he said, I start eating pie.
Listen.
I start eating ice cream.
Listen.
And now you have to start the cycle all over again. And that's what makes it so difficult for heavyweights, because if they're not in a constant, like, who's my guy? Evander Holyfield.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's just phenomenal.
Sure.
Right. But that was his life.
Yeah.
So others, you know, we got other things going on, man.
And so, you know, when I was putting this film together, I have two different, you know, target audiences that I was looking at. Black men, number one, because we are at the lowest stat there is for every health statistic. We are at the bottom, even well behind Black women as well. But my dad at the time, who was making the change at 65, and I was 35. And I'm just like, these are very two pivotal age groups. One for Black men making it to 65 is already a feat, which is unfortunate for many reasons.
In some areas, making it to 30.
Listen.
Real talk.
So at that age, it's to know it's not too late to make a change, because he's made a change at that age. And then for younger people who are getting out of their 20s. Nobody wants to say I'm in my 30s. I'm getting out of my 20s. It's the time to make a change. You got to do something to make a difference, because it will catch up with you.
So it's kind of good. We should have started this from the beginning. So were you a filmmaker?
Yeah.
Study film?
Yeah. So I got into film because my dad did as well. So he was forced into early retirement. He worked at IBM for many years, because of getting sick, he was forced into retirement, and, he needed to pick up a hobby. So he's like, I'm going to get back into, radio television, which was the degree he got at Northern Illinois. And he, started volunteering at the churches and start working for them. So, which means that I started volunteering at the churches without having a decision. I'm just going with him. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I'm really starting to get into this stuff. And so I've been fortunate to know at a very young age what I've wanted to do. after college, started as a editor at ESPN. And then I moved back to Chicago, worked at Big Ten Network, did a lot of freelancing, worked for the Bulls, worked on a lot of different documentaries. And now I run a production company of, there's five of us, and we do a lot of documentaries in the Chicagoland area.
It is, first of all, I'm a fan of documentaries, right? I mean, it just, it's, you learn so much in terms of that. So in terms of, are there documentarians that you look at and say, hey, you know what? I want to model my work, or kind of they influence you?
Yeah, there's a lot. I think, and it's a shameless, I won't say a shameless plug, but the way that Ava DuVernay was telling her stories when she was, I won't say first breaking out, but some of her early documentaries, how she was breaking rules, how she was putting the story together, that let me know. I'm like, yo, I want to do it like her. She's out here killing it, and she's unapologetic about it. And I started thinking about my mortality. I'm like, I'm not going to be here for a long time. You know, if I'm going to tell stories, I want to tell stories that are going to have an impact. And sometimes those aren't always the most palatable one. Mm-hmm. And so I really look at what's been going on in our, I shouldn't even say in the last couple of years, because it's been going on longer than I've been alive, but it's just seen more now because of social media and stuff. But just seeing what's going on in our country, this is how I make a difference, by showcasing different stories that I want people to know more about.
Ken Burns.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the easy one. Ken Burns, like, if he's not on the list, then what are you doing in your life? Ken Burns will make a story about microphones, and you'll watch all 60 minutes of it. It don't matter.
Peter Coyote is the
voice. Yeah.
But what I fell in love with him. Just loved. I love baseball. I think baseball is probably one of the greatest sports documentaries.
Sure, sure.
But fell in love with him when he was talking about the Detroit Tigers, the 68, 69 Detroit Tigers.
Okay.
And they won the World Series.
Okay.
But he went back to talk about the insurrection.
Mm-hmm.
And he used the term, and a lot of people just blew past him. Mm-hmm. He said, 63 Americans lost their lives.
Mm.
Now, normally, that's not how we do the descriptor.
No, not at all.
33 black people lost their lives. Yep. He said 63 Americans lost their lives.
Yeah.
And that whole inclusiveness in terms of us. So I just love the way he does it.
And documentaries have made, you know, with all the streaming platforms, documentaries have made a big push. We need more content because we have more places to have it. You know, before you could, if it wasn't on HBO, it wasn't on one of the big four, I'm going to say, networks, it was hard to get your stuff out there. But now there's a new streaming platform popping up every other day.
What's amazing to me, though, is the, I thought, because again, I watch so many documentaries, I watch news constantly. Mm-hmm. There is so much tape out there.
Yeah, yeah.
I was watching a piece. I don't know if it's Who Killed Malcolm X.
Yep.
But there was some.
My friend produced that. Is that right? Sims. Yep. Mm-hmm.
And there were some scenes I had never seen before.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there is one. And if I ever meet her, I got to ask her, Sonia Sanchez, the poet.
Mm-hmm,
right.
Mm-hmm.
But she's sitting there. You know, she's very Afrocentric, right?
Yeah.
Not in this picture. She had a pillbox hat on. She had the white gloves, and she introduced Malcolm.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, that's what I'm amazed that when we find all of this film,
yeah,
and then you're able to then go and edit it, and then be able to tell a story.
Yeah, and we need to own our own story, because if we don't, somebody else will. Somebody will interpret that footage and put a negative spin. That's the thing about editing and filmmaking that's so precious to me, is that we can both look at the same piece of content, the same footage, and you can put a positive spin on it, and I can put a negative spin, or vice versa. Or I can use music in a certain way, or I can cut the quote at a certain point so it gets my point across. And so we need to be more diligent about telling our own stories.
Which is really amazing, because we've always lived in a sampling society.
Mm-hmm,
if I
mm-hmm.
do a research paper, I'm pulling in other people's work, obviously,
100%.
Come up with my conclusion. And, you know, obviously hip hop just kind of
took that and ran with
right,
it.
Right, right.
10 times over.
Yeah, we still in it.
They ran with it.
You know, it's here now. As Roger said, I'm driving in L.A., and they said, we're going to drop this new song, mm-hmm. and I'm listening. I go, that's my song.
Yeah, yeah.
And then why are these dudes talking over my song?
Yeah, what's going on?
And they didn't even sample. They just took the whole song. When you listen to Rapper's Delight, it's the whole song.
And they're going to run with it. And this is the thing that just hit me the other day. My wife was like, how do you feel that they're starting to sample stuff that came out when we were that age? And I'm like, man, I ain't going to lie. I feel some sort of way.
You know? Look, when rappers are doing reunion tours, they're like the Rolling Stones now. You know
what is going on?
Because many of these rappers in their 50s getting close to, I'm talking about the heyday, the ground floor. They just hit
50, last year. That's crazy.
Yeah, so I'm looking at all these folks who, you know, the 90s was their decade. Mm-hmm. And I'm going, you getting 50.
Yeah. You up
you
there.
Know, yeah, the 80s was mine. The 90s were yours. I mean, it's like.
Yeah.
So you look at it, because I was looking at Kid and Play.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking at these dudes like, man, y'all got old, man.
Yeah. That dance, that two-step ain't hitting the same way that it used to.
They can't do it. How much time do you do your own editing? Or do you have an editor?
This one I did. Okay. And I'll never do it again.
Okay.
My editor is my brother, actually. And I purposely, he's in the industry as well. Decided not to have him on this project because now I'm not going to compare us to Outkast, but to make this comparison, you're going to understand what I'm saying. So, you know, Outkast, you know, Andre, you know, Big Boy, they made all their music, and eventually with Speakerbox and The Love Below, they kind of wanted to do their own thing. They did it together, but they wanted to do it separately. That's what Bike Vessel was for me. So I'm working on Bike Vessel. My brother's working on a gospel project about our aunt, gospel music in Chicagoland area. And what's that?
Who's your
aunt? Udella Evans Reed. So she went to
Clay Evans.
Yeah,
sister?
Yeah. That's my uncle. That's my great uncle.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Never saw anybody direct the choir like that woman directed.
Listen,
like the ship.
Listen, yeah,
oh,
yeah, yeah,
the ship,
yeah. Man. Look at how small this world is. I love it.
Yeah. Oh, man. The ship came to our church. I had never seen, first of all, a choir that big.
Yeah.
But to hear them.
Yeah.
And then Pastor Evans
and
the folks that own the restaurant right over here, Perkins.
Oh, wow.
All grew up together right down there in Brownsville, Tennessee.
That's where my family is. We're literally going down in a month to do some more filming.
Okay.
I remember going down to Brownsville. I hated it.
You hated Brownsville?
I didn't like it. When I was young, because the highlight of it was going to Dairy Queen or Walmart. That's all there was.
So you big city guy.
No, it's not that I'm a big city guy, but there was nothing there. And I'm 8 at the time.
That's what I'm saying. You big city. You used to.
So they're like, look, are we going to go to Walmart today or tomorrow? Because we ain't going twice and you ain't getting nothing there.
Man.
But it was now I go down there with a different mentality because that's where my family's from. It's very important.
Small world.
And so I'm very happy to be there. Yeah. So, yeah, that's my family. And so. He's working on that project.
Okay.
I've worked and completed this, and we've done so many projects together. It was an opportunity for us to say, okay, what does your style look like when I don't influence it and vice versa? And so he consulted and produced and helped out with this, but not from the editing, because I wanted to tell our family story by myself. And so it was great to have his support, and I'm supporting him on his project. But now we're going to have to come up here because when we get the gospel, so it's called the Gospel of Ludella.
Okay.
And we're going to have to come up here and we're going to have to come back so we can be here for it.
Oh, man. And she's passed now, right?
She's still here.
Yeah.
She's still kidding.
And then his daughter, was she a singer?
Clay?
Yeah.
Was his daughter?
There was another Evans.
Yes.
She was young.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes. It's, you know, we got big, you know, because there was like 11, 9 of them. There was a lot of them. You know, I'm still catching up.
He just had his.
Yeah.
He wasn't in a hurry.
Yeah.
And he could just do, I mean.
He can command a room.
Oh, man.
He can command a room.
I was watching his home going.
Yeah. Yeah.
5.5 hours. It was four and a half hours.
I was there for all of it. Yeah. I was like,
and Jesse got up and said, look, y'all could be around like, dude, we talking now, Aretha Franklin, Rosa Parks.
Yeah.
But that's how influential Clay Evans was.
Now, I do remember him saying, don't be taking all day to celebrate me. Like, y'all can celebrate me, but don't be taking all day to do it. But it was important. It was important to see the faces. It was important for Chicago to come out. Right. And honestly, for the younger generation and even in my family, it's good to see that side of it.
And to hear the hear Minister Farrakhan
mm-hmm.
talk about how Jesse had introduced him.
Yep.
And how Jesse, he said that he became his pastor.
Yep.
He's a Muslim.
Yep. Yep. 100%. And look at that. You have just these two powerhouses, three, and they're able to come together at a certain time, even though they have different beliefs. They were still able to come together.
Because it's the village.
Yeah.
You listen to Community Voice. We're joined in studio by Mr. Eric D. Sills. He is the director of Bike Vessel. We're going to take a quick break and be right back.
Milwaukee. This is Michelle Bryant, your host of Say Something Real. When President Joe Biden wanted to talk to Milwaukee voters, he called WNOV.
And welcome President Biden to Milwaukee and to WNOV. How you doing today, sir?
I'm doing well. I had a great event downtown, and I'm at the headquarters now, and we're feeling really good. It's a great day. We have a lot of volunteers, 1,000 volunteers going out here in Wisconsin, out of Milwaukee in particular.
So we are ready to roll in Wisconsin.
Well, I tell you what, God love you. We get Wisconsin, we win it all.
For up-to-date election information, keep it locked on WNOV 860 AM 106.5 FM. Calling all high school students. Do you act, sing, or play an instrument? Are you a scientist, filmmaker, playwright, or visual artist? If so, the NAACP Afro Academic Cultural Technological Scientific Olympics program is for you. Sign up to compete in the local AXO competition on Sunday, April 21st. Gold medalists will automatically win an opportunity to compete at the National NAACP AXO competition in Las Vegas, Nevada this summer. With 32 AXO categories to choose from, there's definitely room to shine. For more information about the NAACP AXO program, visit NAACPMKE.org or call 414-562-1000.
Support also comes from the Milwaukee Art Museum, now presenting Idris Khan, Repeat After Me. Spanning his entire creative journey, the exhibition is the U.S. Museum debut for the British artist. Through photography, sculpture, and painting, visitors will witness Khan's exploration of repetition to mark time. More info is at mam.org.
Hey Milwaukee, my name is Martina, and I'm with the Independent Living Supports Pilot Program team. We help adults 55 plus and those 18 plus living with disabilities, providing up to $7,200 for home services, medical equipment, home modifications, and more. There's less than 30 days left to sign up for this program. See if you qualify today. Call 414-289-6874. Again, that's 414-289-6874. This program is made possible by Milwaukee County and Wisconsin Department of Health and Human Services.
Are you a small business owner looking to scale your business all 2024? Register for our upcoming boot camps every first and third Saturday of the month, where you can learn about personal and business credit, marketing and branding, and how to get funding for your business. Just go on our website, twbcc.com, click the 3000 Black Business Challenge tab, and sign up and register for upcoming dates.
You're listening to Community Voice, where your host is Anki. Welcome back to Community Voice, and again, we're joined in the studio by Mr. Eric D. Sills. He's the director of the film Bike Vessels, as part of Black Lens Milwaukee Film Festival. It had its premiere here Saturday at the Time Cinema. That's in my neighborhood.
Wisconsin premiere. Yeah, holding it down.
Yeah, and then it's playing today, 12:30 at the Oriental Theater.
Yes.
And then tomorrow at 7:30 at the Time Cinema.
Can't wait. Come out.
Yeah. It's so what was that like, man? You and your old man on the road.
It was tough. It was tough. I don't even hide it. He don't even hide it. I wish he was here because he, actually, let me get my side of the story because he can't speak on his. To direct a film, especially from our ride from St. Louis to Chicago, it's 350 miles. So we had a crew of 10 people for those 4 to 5 days. And I was actually riding, you know. So mentally, I mean, I'm doing 10 to 12 hours a day. And I had ridden 100 miles or a century at that point, but I hadn't done it back to back to back. And so it was one of the most challenging things that I've ever done. I won't do it again. And when I say I won't do it again, I won't film it and ride. I'll ride or I'll film, but I won't do them at the same time ever again. But it was important. It was an opportunity for us to set a goal, to meet that goal. We challenged ourselves and we got to work together. So we bumped heads along the way, but that made us stronger for the act. So we did our training, and during our training, we bumped our heads a lot because we're the same person, to no surprise, for the good of the bad and the ugly. But it was better that it happened during the training than on the actual ride because we needed each other at that point.
So was there a bonding?
Oh yeah. When I got into post-production for this project, I was sharing it with close, you know, friends and people in the industry, and I got a lot of unique feedback. But one in particular really touched me. Someone was like, you know, your dad's story, love it. The fact that you all rode from St. Louis to Chicago, love that. But my favorite part is the relationship between you and your dad and how you two interact. And I hadn't seen it like that. You're living in it. You don't see that relationship externally. So I went back and looked at the cut. I'm like, wow, this actually is a good part of the film. And so I leaned in on that. And I've had several Black men come up to me and say, it was great to see a film with a relationship with a father and son that are Black. That was positive. Simply put, we don't see that all the time. And not say we know it exists. And it was good to be able to showcase that on screen.
Well, there's some things that that you all learned about yourselves that would be shared in the movies, and that's if that's the case, just one of if you had multiple.
Sure. I I think your purpose of why you do anything is very important. My dad's purpose on the bike obviously is to get healthy. But he's very competitive and he just competes in everything that he does, which is great. That's who he is. I'm competitive, but in a different state. Once I hung up my cleats in football, I'm sorry, I tore my MCL, so they hung them up for me. I can't run like that no more. Once my cleats got hung up for me, I'm like, I've had my competitive nature and I love what I did. Right now, when I get on the bike, I won automatically. It doesn't matter how fast I go, doesn't matter how far I go, doesn't matter who I ride with by myself. Getting out of the, you know, corporate, behind the computer, you know, just being out in nature by myself, it's very therapeutic. And so that's one of the things that I noticed.
There's nothing to do.
No, you're in your thoughts.
When you were 8,
you bringing it back. No, at 8, I don't want to be in my thoughts. Now, I didn't have there was no iPad or nothing like that. It was just, you just sit there and be quiet.
But you have these existential kind of
not at that age. I mean, I do now, and I think that's important. How many times, let me ask you, I'm not supposed to ask you a question, but I'm going to ask you anyway. When's the last time you just sat and just thought, like, no music, no sounds, no screen on, and you were just in your thoughts?
Man, last week.
Actually, okay, well, that's good. When I was in
the car, you know what I did? Turned off the radio.
Okay, so you just had the road noise going.
Didn't even hear that.
Wow.
You know, I mean, that you're right. That moment, someone had brought up that he was a Quaker.
Okay.
And so they wanted him to do a prayer. He said, well, Quakers don't do public prayers.
Wow, okay.
Because Quakers do contemplation and meditation.
Okay.
And then in that moment, you know, you're able to, and you know, sometimes you got to let your mind it can take you to some uncomfortable spots.
Sure, sure.
But I just like Pandora's box,
mm-hmm.
don't close the box before hope gets out.
Nice.
You know what I mean? So, yeah, you should go through. There should be some uncomfortable things in your life that you're looking at in your exam. So, yeah, I mean, I could appreciate that.
Well, that's I mean, to say it was last week, that was good, because I would say before I was riding, I was just always on the go. And I think that's one of the big things that I took away from this project, seeing my dad's journey is really similar to mine, you know, in the corporate world, trying to make it to the next level. And one of the doctors, one of our expert interviews, said a very unique quote. He said, sometimes you don't understand that there's a death by 1,000 paper cuts. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of small microaggressions that happen over time that will eat at you. Mm-hmm. And then eventually it will just, you know. And so I'm trying to recognize that myself now. And I think the pandemic helped us to a degree as well, realizing that life is short.
Yeah, I think that, and then what drives us, right? I mean, this fearfulness. The one universal, there has been no exception,
mm-hmm.
no exception to their other rules of their exception, no exception to this. Everybody dies.
Mm-hmm.
There has been any documented case where no one has ever not died.
Yep.
But we're fearful of that.
Yeah.
Right. As we get older, we get closer to it. I joke. I said, who's talking about going to heaven? Young people ain't talking about going to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Old people are, right? Mm-hmm. Older folks, because now we're a little bit more mindful of that. And then we try to do all we can. Now, some of it's just good health. And then some of it we think we can just.
Sure.
If I could just hold back the hands of time, we yeah. can.
By the time
turn back, that was turn yeah. back.
I was with you. Time always wins. Undefeated.
Time waits for no one.
Man.
Time waits for no one.
And I think that's what's pushed me more lately. I'm just like, I've been thinking about it. How many deaths in your life do you think about on a weekly basis? Like someone that was close to you. Outside of that, my thought process is, I don't think there's a lot of people's deaths that we think about after they've gone for a certain amount of time. We still love them. You know, people that we looked up to. There's only a handful of them that we think about on a regular basis. And so when I thought about that, I'm like, man, I need to get after it.
Yeah.
For myself, you know, there's not going to be a lot of people that remember me after the fact. So I might as well get it in while I'm here, because after that, there's no coming back from that unless you, I don't know, you looked in your stats. Anybody come back from that?
One person.
Okay. One person.
Just one person.
Well, listen, those odds are stacked against me. Then.
Exactly.
As so many people who live on this, the billions or the trillions.
Just one.
I see how you did that. That was good.
There's a Luther Vandross song that I love. He says that hearts get broken all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But this time, the heart that's broken is mine.
Mm.
And I kind of paraphrase it. People die all the time.
Yeah.
Or people have pain all the time.
Yeah.
Now, this time, I know the person who's died.
Mm-hmm.
And but here's the myth, and I know that we talk about the actuaries in terms of older people.
Mm-hmm.
Statistically, it's not the case. Young people are dying. Middle-aged people are dying.
Way too much.
Right.
Well, way too soon.
You know, that's always one of those.
You don't think so?
Rhetorical question: is it too soon if you die, or is it your time?
Yeah, because not to bring a comedic aspect. And I don't know who said this, but. So what if I'm on the airplane when it's a pilot's time? That's not good.
No, it's not good at all.
It's the pilot's time. It's not my time.
Gonna be your time now.
It's gonna be my time now. And so, I mean
because there's I'm in the religion business.
Yeah,
but there's a randomness to life.
Of course.
There. I mean, you know, you just you go figure. Just my parents being my parents.
Yeah.
That was a random meeting.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I mean, and so it's that. Not knowing, but I think you're right. And then be able to have that shared experience with your dad.
Yeah.
So did the other siblings, did they? Because, you know, everybody wants to be the favorite.
Well, I mean.
But you are.
Right? I mean, how could I not be? I got a sister and a brother, and I love them. I'm the youngest.
Me too.
But it's clear that my parents... Not only do they love me, I won't say the most, but they did the best with me. I mean,
because you're the baby.
Yeah. Well, honestly, this is the thing, though. parents are different when they have, you know, if you got three kids, my brother's 8 years older than me, my sister five. My parents were different people at that time.
Oh, they're financially in a different situation.
In that situation, you know, fingers crossed, I got the best of that situation.
Right. Came along when we was busted, just starting ground floor.
Yeah.
That my sister came along, we were materially better.
Yeah.
And I think that that's always, and so obviously the older sibs are always jealous of the younger sibs because 100%. They like when you didn't get the same whoopings we got. You didn't have the same hardships we had, yeah. You know, so it goes on.
I tell my family I learned from my brother's mistakes a lot earlier and faster. And I feel like I was in my little 8-year-old notebook. I said, okay, don't talk back when dad is hungry. Not a good time to talk back. I learned quicker. And they just said my parents were tired. Maybe so. But I also saw, I'm like, don't want to be in that situation.
You know, it's funny because my mother used to say to my brother, oh, you like getting whoopings. I'm thinking, I think he does.
That's what I'm saying.
Did he get caught? I think he does. Because he never understood. Clearly, the object is not to get caught.
Yeah. That's
how
it works.
One of the things that seems sometimes it would be a disconnect.
Yeah.
You know, between, you know, obviously, because I remember my brother said one time, he said, ooh, if mama knew what she was doing.
But she don't.
But she don't.
Yeah.
Unless you in there doing what I think you're doing.
Yeah.
Snitching.
Yeah. Come on.
But that was funny. Now, this is interesting about my mother.
Yeah.
My mother didn't like snitches.
Oh. So the person who told would get in trouble.
Right. She said, you don't snitch on your brothers and sisters. So that was interesting. You didn't have to worry about it. She get her intel through other means.
Oh, because she knew. She knew. Yeah.
Now, my grandmother on that hand, she didn't care. My grandmother looked like one of those old movies where they have you with the bright light.
Yeah.
My grandmother going to sweat it out of you.
Yeah.
Oh, she going to do the interrogation.
Said, I got the time. Let's go.
Oh, she got the time. And I don't know if she, there wasn't no good cop, bad cop.
Yeah.
She's the only cop.
The only cop. So what you going to do?
What you going to do? I got to ask you a real serious question, man. Are the Bears going to take Caleb Williams with the first pick?
Oh, you act like, you know, I was ready for that. I'm like, what are you going to come with this time? I broke up with the Bears a long time ago.
You're going to be back on the bandwagon. Listen, come on, man. Do you have another team?
You know, I talked to my friends. How do you find another team? Because it's like, do you pick
a team
that's
you don't
want to
break up. You don't want to leave.
Listen, we're separated. Let's say that.
All right.
We're
the door is still open.
We are separated. Let me tell you something.
Will Caleb Williams bring you back home?
Listen, honestly, you know, the organization has been.
Since forever
okay. When it comes to QB. So when they tell you who they are, you got to believe them.
That's true.
Right. And so
they have never drafted a great quarterback. They never have.
Okay.
McMahon came free agency or trade?
Yeah. And so, and I'm not going to speak on Jay because I did like Jay.
Cutler.
Yeah. I like Phil.
Oh, certainly. We loved him too.
Yeah. I'm sure you did.
We loved him. We loved him because as long as Jay Cutler was playing, Packers was always in the game.
Yeah.
We
but honestly, do Packers really have, let's be honest, do you really have to? It's not even a rivalry anymore. And I'm telling you, that's something from the Chicagoland area, live there now. I'm telling you, it's not even fun anymore. Like, I don't even, like, when the Packers play the Bears, I don't even text my Packer friends anymore. Because why? It's pointless.
Oh, man.
And I'm quick to recognize it. Like, it's not a rivalry.
You only have to win two games.
How is it been? Justin Fields never beat the Packers. Has it been a decade?
I don't think Justin Fields ever beat the Packers.
Maybe Trubisky. I don't know, but it's been close to a decade.
Boy, you talk about the Jay Cutler. My nephew was such a big Jay Cutler.
You know what?
He lives in Miami.
Let me tell you why I like Jay. Because Jay didn't care. Jay didn't care. He's like, I don't care what none of y'all think. Now I might throw 8 interceptions. But
when the game's on the line, because those first 3 quarters,
you
get killed by Jay Cutler. We go just
100%.
Just wait.
He wants to throw like Favre. That's why
they have the first and the 5th, 6th pick.
Yeah. So, I hope the best for them. I wish no ill on any person, team to try to figure out their stadium situation. A lot of us like Justin Fields, I still do. I understand it's a business. They have to do what they have to do because you have a once in a lifetime opportunity with Caleb Williams. And I hope it works out. But honestly, I hope the Bears don't ruin his career, because a lot of us say, oh, well, we could have got Patrick Mahomes. But that wouldn't have been the same Patrick Mahomes if he came here versus if he went to Kansas City.
Right. Well, about, I think, but you have Andy Reid, too.
That's what I'm saying. Like, it's not just a player. It's also the culture that you put them.
Right. And the talent around
And the talent around them. So,
because they didn't get a right receiver until last year. But by that time, they had no offensive line.
Exactly. So, I hope the best for them. But they were ruining my Sundays. And I'm like, I'm tired of my Sundays being ruined by the Bears. So, I'm like, we got to separate. Okay? We separated.
You know, it's amazing. My buddy lives in Tampa.
Yeah.
And his buddy, our buddy, who grew up in Milwaukee, mm-hmm. is a Bears fan.
Okay.
So he's person not grow out of here.
Right? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So my buddy calls me and he says, hey, man, I'm trying to get some Bears gear for Mike.
Mm-hmm.
I said, now, first of all, I don't know why you're coming to me trying to get Bears gear. That I don't understand. But okay, you're my guy.
Yeah, I'll do what I can.
So I called around. You know, people value their customer service. Call a store that sells Packer memorabilia and ask for Bears stuff and see how rude those folks are going to be.
Mm.
The closest place you can really get Bears gear is Kenosha.
Okay, that makes sense.
Which we believe is part of Illinois anyway. But it's hard.
It's funny you say that. We feel that same way about Waukegan.
Do you? It's part of Wisconsin.
Look, once you get to a certain point,
is it north of the toll? No, yeah, it's south of the toll.
It's like
south of the toll.
It's right. I mean, it's right there by Six Flags. I don't know. That's close enough to me.
But back in the day, we used to go to Zion to roller skate.
Yeah,
Illinois. I mean, it was. I mean, people kind of that close to the border.
Yeah,
it's like the people who live up La Crosse, Hudson, Wisconsin.
Okay,
they're on the border with Minnesota.
Yeah.
So if you watch a Vikings-Packer game, about a third of the audience is Packers.
I believe it.
Because they crossed the river, you know, to go into Minnesota.
Yeah, well, when it comes to our sports teams, I'll never be a Packers fan, but
I saw this in Philly back in the day when the Flyers were really, you know, the bullies of Broad Street.
Mm-hmm.
And when they would win the Stanley Cup, you know, black people out there with hockey sweaters on. So is that the same way with the Blackhawks?
Oh, because I was out there too. I was out there too. I've been to one hockey game in my life, and it wasn't the Blackhawks. It was when I lived in Connecticut, but it didn't matter. We were celebrating. Because listen, up to that point, I can't do the math. I don't know, but we hadn't.
Blackhawks had been good.
No, but I was think about Chicago team in general. What was the championship before that? Because we're talking about 2012, 2013 with the Blackhawks.
Cups.
No, that was after. That was 2016. Yeah, that was after.
When did the Cubs win their first World Series? Is that 2016?
Well, yeah, their first one. Well, yeah. That's 2016. I mean.
The Sox?
2005.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a long time. That's a long time. The Packers probably won two in that time frame. No, one. But
yeah,
that was the year that we y'all knocked us out. Because y'all had I think you all were a wild card.
Mm. Wasn't it one year the Cutler kind of threw you all out of it too through an interception?
Yeah. I mean, that's every game.
That guy, we sent him flowers.
Hey, listen to the thing. You gotta win with him and lose with him. So I'm okay with it.
We had Brett Favre. So
listen,
you know,
Favre threw some interceptions too.
He set the record. and he's done some. Yeah. We have a game, I'm sure in every franchise, there's always the worst game or the worst day in the history of that franchise.
Uh-huh.
And until we lost to Seattle, it was the 4th and 26 game, 4th and 26 against the Eagles.
Mm.
Here we go. We're going to the Super Bowl, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so the Eagles is 4th and 26. I'm trying to think. I don't know if it's Don Capers, whoever the defensive coordinator. He called a defense for 4th and 27.
Wow.
Remember that, Debo? They pick up 26 yards.
Wow.
Get the first down. Okay, fine. They go down. I think they score.
Yeah.
But the Packers are still now it's tied.
Yeah.
No. Brett Favre throws an interception.
Listen.
And they come down and score, and the rest is history. We don't go. And we're not even going to talk about the game he quit in 2008 against the Bears. Against the Giants. Remember the year they went on a run?
I do.
And it got cold and he quit. He also quit in the second Super Bowl.
But that's a little different cold up here. That's a little different.
I almost dropped the word.
Listen.
Come on, man.
That's a little different cold.
He been playing for 10 years. Yeah,
That day it got him. That day. Listen, let me put it this way.
And then he's stealing money.
Yeah, it got him that day. Look.
And then let me put it this way. He quit that day.
Y'all can't complain.
He quit.
No Packer fan can complain to me if they have won a Super Bowl in their lifetime, because I can't say that. I was on the way, but I was not here yet.
Probably see a black president before you see the Bears West.
That's horrible. Wow.
I was going to say a black president before I see the Bears win a Super Bowl.
You know.
And that has happened, haven't you?
And it has. Yeah.
From Chicago.
I saw a black president before I saw. That's a t-shirt right there.
That's a t-shirt,
I saw
right.
A black president before I saw a Super Bowl. Help us, please. Help us, please.
Well, you know, and they're still, I'm trying to think of the franchises who still have not won a Super Bowl. Cleveland.
Yeah, it's just a couple. It's not too
Detroit.
Many of them. Jacksonville.
Jacksonville. Well, they're kind of, they made one though, didn't they? When Tony Brasile, I thought they got close if they didn't. Carolina's never won one.
Mm-hmm. San Diego. It's not
Chargers never have.
Yeah, it's not that many.
Not that many.
If we saw pure Super Bowl, because like if we want to go on stats, when it comes to championships, the Bears still have the most. But we got to go back to like 1920. But that's okay. It was before Super Bowl.
Who knows?
Oh, we can.
New England.
No. It's got to be one of the original teams. It's got to either be New York. The Chicago
Giants, Eagles.
I said Detroit already.
Bless you. In the second year.
Yeah, so it's got to be one of them because you know George Halas was winning them every other year, but there was only you know four teams and two black players. So,
winning black players then.
Yeah,
either black players.
Because when did
post World War II?
The post World War II. So yeah,
Skip, you know Pollard, but that was different. That
was Bulldogs.
But not until. After World War II, that black players.
I'm blanking out on the running back's name. Who am I? Gale Sayers. When did he come?
Gale Sayers, 60s, 70s. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. How about that? How do you get Gale Sayers and Dick Butkus in the same draft for the same team?
He's rigged. He bought them. That's why. He said, look, he was a Jerry Jones back then. If Jerry Jones read the book of George Halas and said, this is how we're going
to
do it.
Oh, man. And to see Jerry Jones' reaction when the Packers was whooping up on the Cowboys. Yeah. That's not supposed to happen.
He got let go of the team.
But, you know, it's amazing. The Dallas, it is America's team.
Oh, 100%.
It's like,
and America can be wrong sometimes, too.
Oh, America's been wrong.
Stays wrong.
Been wrong.
So you can root for them all you want.
Dak
but
Prescott. So how are you Bulls going to do? They're in the play-in?
I don't do basketball. You don't do basketball. Nah, I'm not. I can pretend. If you want me to, but I'd be lying to you.
Yeah, you got to tell me from like 91
to, I mean, like,
to 98, you weren't a basketball fan.
I mean, I didn't have a choice. I mean, I was with the greatest team of all time, with the greatest player of all time. Like, you don't have a choice. But then after that, I mean, the NBA greatest for like 20s. Oh, I mean, who else is there?
There were some Celtic teams that was pretty good. There certainly was some Laker teams.
Look, they didn't even have a 3-point. They didn't have to. All they had to do was throw it down and, you know what I'm saying, Robert Parrish will throw it up.
No, but that but you know that the because you know they had to get past the Celtics.
Yeah,
Jordan.
They did, but you know a lot of the criticism that I see now is the teams that he had to get past the Celtics and Detroit and Lakers was they were on their downfall. Like they were older. Obviously they were older.
Yeah, but I don't. You know what? I'm like if you put them on the floor.
Yeah,
I mean it's like the Bucks. The Bucks could my buddy. My GM buddy down in Florida says that he believes that the Bucks are going to get swept in the first round. He believes they're going to be, and they have a team that they do not match up well against.
Was that 2 years ago y'all got y'all's?
Yes.
How was it?
It was not a very good feeling.
No?
No, not at all.
What am I missing?
Missing not, it wasn't a very good feeling.
Okay.
It was, and I think the other thing that hurt us, you know, it's going to be this trade is going to go back and forth. But I knew the kiss of death was when Charles Barkley said, oh, you might as well pencil the Bucks in the NBA Finals.
Oh,
that's the kiss of death. Yeah, that's the jinx. That is, you want to sneak up on folks, do what Miami does every year.
Yeah.
You know, be the ninth seed and all of a sudden they're in the NBA Finals. How did that happen?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just, you know, baseball Cubs fan.
Oh no.
Oh, Southside. South.
Yeah. Side, no, I couldn't support the Cubs. No. No. I can't support a team. I'm not a big baseball fan. Yeah, football was my thing. Basketball, same thing. More so football, but just the ideology of the Cubs. Actually, really similar to the Bears. We don't have to win because we're gonna sell out anyway.
Well, yeah, because you only got a 15th, what, the 30,000.
True.
I mean, it's easy.
True, but like at the end of the day, if we're looking at it as a business, and so I'm just like, they're not trying to win. People go there to celebrate, you know, being able to drink and eat hot dogs and all that type of stuff. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Well, that's what a baseball game is for.
You're right, but like, let's separate that from the team. It's an event.
I went to a game, and by the sixth inning, I didn't know who was playing.
I believe it.
You know, I
hear
no
that
clue.
On a regular basis.
Oh man, that's what.
Who's and playing
because
today?
Baseball is such a game where you sit.
Yeah.
And it's a slower moving game.
Yeah.
That means you have a lot of downtime.
Yeah.
And so that means when people passing beers,
yeah,
you know, pass one over here.
Yeah, if I'm gonna support a baseball team in Chicago, it's definitely the White Sox, and there's no way I support
Barack Obama's team.
Yeah, that's one way to look at it.
Yeah, yeah. You know, Barack Obama only lost one election.
Which one's that?
He ran against Bobby Rush.
Oh,
that's the only election he ever lost.
That's interesting.
And he didn't just lose it.
He got
spanked.
Well, a lot of, as I do more reading on his history, a lot of people were mad at him because they said, it's not your time yet. You got to wait. And he said, wait for who? And so, you know, the powers that be, you know. But he found a way around it, obviously.
I think Barack Obama was, first of all, he's gifted.
Mm-hmm.
But he was also very fortunate. Some things fell his way. And look.
They have to.
That right. Thank that, you.
Yeah.
Thank
but you got to be able to receive your blessings, too. You got to be able to receive them, too. That's part of it.
Yeah. You know, God is knocking, and you back here doing something like, dude, you're knocking.
You got to be ready.
Oh, man. But no, you have to be. And somebody says sometimes it's better to be lucky than good.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, good fortune. He stepped in, yep. Right? The right. You know, so to be able to run. And then the guy he ran against got into a sex scandal.
Mm.
They couldn't figure out who to run against. They were going to run Dicker against him.
What?
Yeah, they were going to run Dicker. Ended up settling on Alan Keyes. We were on our way to D.C.
Dicker.
Yeah, and then I'm going to say it again, 2008.
Yeah.
He ran against, which is kind of crazy, but he ran against someone and McCain looked old.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And Obama, and I think it was just that moment in America where people felt like, okay,
need something different.
Well, let's. But then he got reelected.
Yeah.
So then it wasn't a fluke.
And then the country said we need something different after him too.
There you go.
So what?
And that's what I tell people. I said, you know, if you have good, you're going to have evil, right? That is the laws of opposites.
Wow.
So if you get Obama, you know, you could get Trump, and then, you know, Biden is someplace in the middle. But I'm going to take that middle.
Yeah, that says a lot, because what else do we have?
Yeah.
Not a lot.
You're listening to Community Voice. We're up on the last break of the program. We'll be right back.
Join the Wisconsin Black Chamber of Commerce every third Thursday at 10 a.m. inside Community Voice with Keith Paris for the Black Chamber Moment. Tune in as we discuss business, networking, and money as we make Black people the largest employer of Black people here on 860 WNOV and 106.5 FM.
Now on stage at Milwaukee Rep, fiery anthems from the High Priestess of Soul in Nina Simone for Women. This inspirational show shines a light on the civil rights icon, featuring live performances of hits like Everything Must Change and To Be Young, Gifted, and Black. Broadway World calls Nina's trailblazing journey riveting, relevant, and oh so real as she becomes the unforgettable voice behind impactful songs that you're going to love. Nina Simone for Women is at Milwaukee Rep now to May 12th.
tickets at MilwaukeeRep.com.
Brownstone Social Lounge, Milwaukee's premier downtown social lounge for good vibes, good music, and good food. Offers all-day happy hour every Tuesday and Wednesday. $6 wings, $8 flatbreads, drink specials, and more. Essential Tuesdays, all essential workers receive 10% off their purchase with proof of ID every Tuesday. Kick back with R&B karaoke Thursday beginning at 7 p.m., followed by Throwback Thursday. Brownstone Social Lounge, great food, great drinks, fresh hookah, located at 524 North Water Street.
Regulators!
Round two, second round, round two. Hey, this is Mr. Winky Blue, and I want to invite you to another fabulous town hall fish fry where the rednecks in the woods and the thugs in the hood collide and we set that mess to the side.
If you know like I know, you don't want to step to this. It's the Chief Funk era, funked out with a gangster twist.
Hey, this is Greg Kennedy, and I'm cordially inviting you to our second town hall meeting, April 26th, 5:30 p.m. You want to be there. Free vapes will be sponsored by Cool Breeze Vape Company. The first 50 people through the door will receive those. This is another Winky Blue production, and you don't want to miss it. April 26th, 5:30 p.m., 100 Gems Restaurant, 6727 North Titonia Avenue. Don't meet us there, meet us there.
Hi, my name is Tamika Vukovic, co-executive director of Wisconsin Voices. Please join Wisconsin Voices every Monday, Tuesday, and Friday. We will be focusing on community partnerships, voter education, and long-term collective impact for all Wisconsinites.
Right, I'm back. Let me thank Miss Michelle Bryant. Let me thank Debo. Let me thank El Boogie. Let me thank Mr. George Akpan, Nicole Goins, Pastor Andrew Calhoun, and Mr. Eric C. Seals as being a part of our program today. Thank you. Again, we're in the middle of Milwaukee Film. If you want to this afternoon, you can get over and see Bike Vessels. It starts at 12:30 today.
On my way there now.
At the Oriental Theater. Good Lord willing, creek don't rise. Hope to talk to everybody tomorrow. And as always, go from this place in peace.